Hi, everybody. It's me, Miss Tina Z, your favorite gender nonconforming ukulelist and vocalist. How are you? Excellent. I'm fine as well. Thank you for asking. I'm going to move you over here. Hold on. You're flying. Yay. I'm going to sing at you just a little bit, so I'm going to move you closer to my microphone. Most of this video, I will be talking. This is a TED Talk. This is a Tina Talk. I was singing at you just a little bit ago, just a little bit though. So, I'm talking about art, I'm talking about songwriting, and I'm talking about the Struts. Yay! Your favorite band, my favorite band. And I'm talking about Luke Spiller's songwriting in particular. Yay! Your favorite lead singer, my favorite lead singer. So, but before I plow ahead, I want you to take out two tacks. Thumbtacks, we're going to pin a couple things. The first thing we're going to pin is that I am transgender. Duh. Pinning that right there. We'll get back to that. The next thing is I had a conversation with Luke Spiller after the Tempe, Arizona Struts show a couple weeks ago. And we talked about the upcoming album. And I wanted to share my interpretation of what he said. And I'm going to share the conversation. That's right. Boop. There, we're going to get back to that. But first thing we're going to do is talk about Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah is a song by Leonard Cohen. And I was so thrilled to see that Mike Garson and Luke Spiller performed Hallelujah at one of their acoustic shows recently. And I was excited to see that because I cover it too. And Luke and I are among a million other artists who cover that song. And the thing I love about this song, and I'm so glad that Luke did it, is because it is one of these songs that you can interpret so many different ways. And people have interpreted this thing so many different ways. And it's just an incredible song. And so I'm going to tell you how I interpret it. And then I'm going to play, and I'm going to play a little bit of that live. And then I'm going to play Luke's, the cut of Luke from the same verse. And I'm going to ask you what you think of how he interprets it. And then I'm going to talk about art. So, buckle in! So the way I interpret Hallelujah is from the point of view of someone who has just lost a significant love. So let's just say it's a married couple, and it's from the guy's point of view, and they've been married 15 years. It was a long, committed relationship, and to him, it was spiritual. It was amazing. It was unbelievable, and he has just been betrayed. And this is fresh. This is 24 hours ago. This is how I read the lyrics. This is how I interpret the lyrics, that it's someone who has been hurt very, very badly and very, very recently, and he's trying to explain to her how much he's hurt. Okay, so the verses, sorry. So the verses to me are filled with righteous indignation and anger and betrayal and disgust and hurt and all these things. But when you get to Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah in the chorus, to me, it's not Hallelujah. To me, it comes off as how could you? It's he's cast away all the other emotions and he's just left with heartbreak. And he's saying, how could you? How could you? That's the way I interpret the song. So I'm going to play one verse and one chorus and then we'll get back to Luke.
There was a time when you let me know what's really going on below, but now you never show it to me, do ya? And remember when I'm looking at you.
There we go. So that's mine. Now here, in a different key, I play it in D, I play it in the key of D, sing it in the key of D, Luke sings it in the key of E, but here's his, yay!
Well, there was a time when you let me know, it's really going on below, but now you never show that to me, do you?
Beautiful. So, I've told you how I interpret the song, my interpretation of the lyrics. I'm not sure exactly how Luke interprets it, but I think from based on the intensity in his verses, he might interpret it similar to me. I don't know that. He seems to be more tender in his chorus of Hallelujah, Hallelujah. As though there's a little hopefulness in there, maybe? I don't know. Anyway, the point of that would be that as artists, Luke and I have to find our way in that song. We have to discover the core to us, the emotional core, and then deliver that to people. That's what an artist does. That's what art is. Art is someone taking someone delivering something and hoping for an emotional connection, an emotional reaction. That's what art is. And so when you're delivering art that you didn't create, I didn't write Hallelujah, Luke didn't write Hallelujah, the both of us have to find our way in it. And deliver it in that way. And I know some people might be tempted right now to say, Tina Z, how dare you compare yourself to Luke? I am not. I understand that Luke and I are on separate realms talent-wise. He performs for thousands of people. I perform for tens of people. I know this. I know this about myself. However, if I were performing sold out Madison Square Garden, I would not prepare any differently. I prepare for gigs, and I gig out. I prepare for gigs, especially cover songs, by delving into them and finding how I can deliver them with authenticity, because that's what it's all about. When you deliver something fake, inauthentic, people can sniff that out from miles around. And so I always am cognizant of not to phone it in. And that said, it doesn't all have to be serious and weighty and big, okay? So there's a song by Poison that we cover, Nothing But a Good Time. And it starts off with, not a dime, I can't pay my rent, I can barely make it through the week. Saturday night, I like to make my girl, but right now I can't make ends meet. And this is blues based. I mean, that's a working man sort of, you know, I gotta get to Friday so I can live. And so many people can relate to that. Yes, yes. So it doesn't have to be super serious and slow and sort of prodding. It can be, you know, big hair and pretty makeup, like Poison, you know. So art is art is art. And that's what's so beautiful about our art. And that's what I love about art. And so that brings me to the first thing. I am transgender. Duh. Did I say duh already? So I'm going to try to get through this really fast. But I grew up in Nebraska, the middle of the United States of America, where for someone born with a male biological body, which I was, to want to be feminine is the worst thing ever. It is the worst thing. There's nothing worse than that growing up as someone who looks like a little boy but who identifies differently. Oh, so much shame and guilt and all kinds of stuff. And especially because later in life, when I was a teenager, I had to pilfer clothes from friends' moms and sisters and things like that. And it's because I would have to sneak down into my room and lock the door and put on something and be able to breathe. And that was it for me. That's always been the thing for me, is to be able to breathe. And so, for years and years and years, all of that guilt, all of that shame, all of that self-hate, that disgust, that awful, awful stuff was okay. I could live with it because I'd always put it away. I'd always put it up on a shelf. It was a thing I did. I would sneak away and do all these bad, bad things and then be done with it and put it on a shelf. And then I could put the labels on the box or whatever it is. I could say sinner or freak or thief or whatever. Put the labels on the thing. It's not me, it's this. But then I started to get real about myself and had some therapy, and my therapist said, you know, after a while, she said, you know, you're going to have to come to the realization, you're going to have to deal with the realization that Tina Z is not a thing you do. Tina Z is you. It's you as a person. And so, ta-da, that box disappeared, the convenient box. But all those labels, all those nasty, nasty labels did not disappear. Suddenly, those stuck to me. And this was 2014 or so, and so I discovered that's the reason why I have so much trouble accepting love. Because all these labels are on me, and I kind of hated myself, and I'm working on that. I almost said hate myself. I stopped myself. I don't hate myself. There are times where all that past stuff catches up to me and affects me. And so I'm working on that. And so, transness is this massive thing that's always been in my life. It's huge. It's this big central thing. And it's at the same time the thing that fulfills me and gives me balance and peace and happiness and also anguish and guilt and shame. And it's this massive, immense thing. And I never, ever, ever wrote a song about it. I've been writing songs for a long, long time, and I never even dared approach writing about it. And that changed when Luke Spiller entered my life. So the first time I wrote about transness was a song called When You Show. If you're on the Strutters, if you're on this Facebook Strutters page, search for it if you want. Luke sings it with me. But the song exists because of Luke's influence in my life. And so since that time, I've written two other songs specifically about transness, as it pertains to me. One of them is called Breach. That's my newest one. It's called Breach. And I'll put that I'll put Breach in the comments so you can look at it if you want to. But Breach is specifically about those labels, those awful, awful labels that I put on myself. And I describe them as chains. And so it's still this whole metaphor of being drowning in this lake, this dark, deep lake. And I'm trying to find the breach. I'm trying to find a way to breathe. And these chains, and I can't do it with these chains on me. So that's the whole point, is I have to get rid of these chains so I can breathe, so I can approach being myself. So it's a big song, and it says exactly what I want it to say. It's so far the only one that says exactly what I want it to say, and I've performed it one time out at a gig. It's a big, big emotional song, so it's hard for me to do, it's hard for me to perform, but I did it one time. And two people after the gig came up to me and specifically referenced the song and said, holy cow. They didn't say cow. They said, wow, that was a big song. That was big. And the thing is, they aren't trans. They weren't transgender people. They were other friends of mine who aren't trans, but they connected to it in a big way, this big emotional way, which for an artist is what I... That's the only thing you can hope for. That's what you go for, is putting something out there that people will connect with. But I'm saying exactly what I want to say in that song. And it's big, and it's emotional, and it's raw, and it's vulnerable, and they connected to it. I'm assuming they connected to it because it's thematically it's about negative self-talk, and you have to get rid of that because it's so detrimental to you. And so I think, I'm guessing that's how they connected with it. So yay! As an artist, I was thrilled by that. So now we're going to take this other one off. We finally get to the Struts. Yay! So I had this conversation with Luke after the gig in Tempe, and I talked to him about, well, the first thing I did was verify that Tina Z is his favorite gender nonconforming ukulelist. I hopefully you saw that funny video. But after that, I talked to him about the album the Struts are working on, and, you know, what's the progress on that? What's that? When will we see that? And I'll put the conversation there so you can hear it and interpret how you want to. But for me, the exciting things were, well, a couple exciting things. The first one, he said, was they're at the point where they have, I think he said, a pile of gold or a stack of gold or something like that, and now they're digging for diamonds. And by diamonds, he meant the hit song, the big fun song that the Struts are known for, that they're very good at. And he said that it has worked this way a couple times already, where the last things that they get to ended up being Body Talks and Kiss This and Could Have Been Me and all these classic Struts songs that we love so much. So yay, I'm excited about that. But the thing that I'm really excited about is when he was talking about the pile of gold. He said, I've said what I wanted to say. Which is, for me, my little heart went pitter patter pitter patter, because I thought back immediately to Breach, and Breach says exactly what I wanted to say, and it's big. It says big, big stuff. And so I'm hoping that when Luke said, I've said the things that I wanted to say with this pile of gold, that he's talking about that, being vulnerable and being open and being big and being whatever. And it's okay that we might not know the specific situation, like people weren't relating to it because, weren't relating to my song because they are trans, but it's like the big theme of being good to yourself. I hope that Luke is going to put himself out there with things that are maybe specific only to him, but are big emotional things that we can connect with. Because one of the magical things about the Struts, and I very few bands have this sort of thing, that we connect with Strutters, fans, connect with this band on that level a lot. And it's a unique thing, and it's such a beautiful thing. And so I hope that when Luke said that, that's what he was referring to. And I think maybe he is, because he also said that he also described the album as it's different. It's a different Struts album. Not reggae. He said, don't worry, it's not reggae. But I think and what I hope he meant was that it's tone-wise, or maybe subject matter-wise, that he went there, that he stepped out there. And that we can expect that sort of thing. And I hope that's right. I don't know if that's right. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's rap. I don't know. Anyway, so that's the whole video. Yay! You made it. Thank you for being here. I'm just going to put the whole conversation right here for you to listen to. Tell me what you think Luke was talking about. And I hope 2023 is hashtag Year of the Struts again. That a new album is coming our way, because we're going to love it. No matter what. Yay! Okay, thanks for watching. Bye!
How's it going? Yeah. All right. Hello!
Hi!
Nice to see you again.
I just have a question for you, if you don't mind.
Okay, hit me.
Your favorite gender non-conforming ukulelist and vocalist is Tina Z, is this correct?
Absolutely correct. Absolutely.
Awesome show.
Did you enjoy it?
Oh, amazing.
I'm sorry I've been getting too much of your messages and stuff.
Please.
I'd be like, I was super sick, I had a kidney infection.
Oh, goodness. and then I had to get straight back into the studio, and then very soon after that we had to start doing these shows. One of them I actually cancelled, so, well, it got moved. So.
When do you think new album is out?
Oh, it's, I mean, like, the majority of it is done, but now we're just kind of fishing for the... We've got a lot of gold, now we're just mining for diamonds. It's like, every time we do a record, the singles always seem to like come last, you know what I mean? So you do what you want to do, and then like, you say everything you want to say, and then that's when you start pushing and pushing and pushing. And then it comes, something like just really good. Like Body Talks was like one of the last songs that was written on Young and Dangerous, yeah. Could have been me and Kiss This were probably like the last few songs that were written.
Is that because the pressure's off and like you have 10 in the
can? No, the pressure's on.
Oh, the pressure's on.
Because that's when everyone says to you, like, yeah, it's good, but it's not good enough.
Where's the hit?
Yeah, like exactly. Oh. So you're like, oh, okay, fuck. And then you start really working towards it, you know?
All right, so you write, do you go about trying to write a hit? Or do you
No, you just sort of think, okay, well, what don't we have? Like, you listen to everything and you think, okay, well, as simple as like, okay, well, we got a lot of songs in this tempo and this feel. What haven't we covered musically? Sometimes that can be a ballad. Sometimes it can be something that's like really hard. And sometimes it's, you know, it's just what's missing, you know? So we're at that stage.
So are you, when you're doing an album, do you look at it as a whole package?
Yeah,
like
absolutely.
So what's not here yet?
I don't really know. I haven't sat down and thought about it yet. But I mean, I will. But I tell you what, we've covered a lot of ground, which is really exciting. And it's going to be different. It's going to be different, you know, in a good way. Not like in a bad way.
No.
We're not making like a reggae record. Not that that's bad, you know, but like it's still rock. It's just a little bit more groovy, you know. So it's gonna be great.
Yeah, we love you.
Love you too.
Support everything.
I honestly, I love all your videos and I love everything that you do. It's really great.
Sorry if I.
Would you like a picture?
Oh yeah.
Okay.